know that Jesus can, and we look forward to the hope that he will come again, whether soon or later. I'm glad that we're able to come together and praise him. I know that we have joy because death has been destroyed. Let's stand together and honor in his word. Jesus presented another parable to them. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that a man took and he sowed in his field. The smallest of all seeds, but when it's grown, it's taller than a garden plant and becomes a tree. That the birds of the sky come and nest on its branches. Jesus told another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven that a woman took and mixed into 50 pounds of flour until all of it was leavened. Jesus told the crowds all these things in parables, and he did not tell them anything without a parable, so that what was spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. I will open my mouth in parables. I will declare things kept secret from the foundation of the world. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. As we meditate on what these two parables mean, help us today. You preach these two small sections. You know that they're very important. And help us to understand we have hope. That hope is clear. That heaven is there. We ask in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Kingdom. His own kingdom of earth. You know that we are in here today. We're in the kingdom of heaven. We're still among the kingdom. We're still not spreading the gospel. You know that the media, the news, you know, the church declining. But I tell you, remember a few years ago when articles talking about the churches are declining in Europe, the churches are declining throughout the world. Christians are less and less. But I can tell you something, the gospel is still being spread, especially in Iran, China. They don't hide it. They're underground. Where it's underground, you see that the gospel is being spread with great passion. I can't see it. It's hidden. If you cut it, you're murdered. Killed. But the word is still spread among people in darkness. One day, America will be changed. Do not be surprised. When that time, if America becomes a communist nation, that's when Christianity would spread more. Because whenever there's people that are free, they tend to become lazy and complacent. But when we're under duress, then we turn toward God and we become a passionate for the Lord. Let's talk about the mustard seed. Tiny. When it's planted, it's the smallest seed, but when it grows, it becomes a large tree. So why did Jesus talk about the mustard seed? I want to show it. It's a little bit hard. I'll interpret because the caption is kind of small. I took a clip from this Instagram. I really liked it. people who are out in darkness, they don't see the beauty of this. Okay, this is a holy Bible. Holy. Bible, y'all know what Bible means. What does Bible mean? I know that we say in Jesus' book, yes. But what does the word Bible really mean? Book, it just means book. Okay? Jesus' book. It's just a book. Some people get barbecue Bibles, you know, barbecue Bible in the store. It just means like a book about barbecue. Or if you see the word Bible and a cooking Bible, you know, it's not that. It means book, a cooking book. You know, we should say holy Bible because that defines what this is. It's the holy Bible. It's holy. God spoke to us. Okay. Praise Him for what He's given us. So this is going to talk about the Bible, the Holy Bible. I'm going to try my best to translate what she's saying. Says the Bible, when it opens up, is translated into 2,200 languages. Okay, it's sad because the whole Bible in ASL is only one. One translation. One. And they finished it in 2020. Okay? It's not that long ago. 2020? You mean they should have been finished with that Bible and ASL a long time ago, but it was very slow translation. They tend to be last to finish. They have translations in all these other languages. ASL is one of the last ones to translate the Bible into their language. Finally, we have 66 books in ASL. Now, foreign sign languages, no, they don't have, they're still a work in progress. This is translating into all those other sign languages. It's 2,201 now, because ASL Bible. The Bible is translated in 2,221. Every minute of the last year, like Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings. More people have lost their lives over this book. This book brings life. King David said, the word is a lamp unto my feet and light unto my path, which means the Bible won't help. It will give you direction for the future. The sentence says, speak. And my servant will be healed. Matthew 4:4, a man cannot live by bread alone, but by the word of God. That means material things are right here in the Bible too. The Bible has a message, and that message is that you're loved. And message, people with baggage and issues, but throughout scripture, God shows grace and love and mercy. The Bible. You know, when you flip through it, King David, he messed up his life so many times. He was an adulterer, murderer. Moses messed up. You know, Paul denied Christ, on and on and on. You look at these people who were, you know, Samuel, who was, and Samson, who was, you know, drawn away by women. This, the Bible is full of sinners, full of sinners. Again, it's grace and mercy that He uses us. Many people sin. They don't want to come to church because they're hypocrites. Yeah. Many people in the Bible messed up in our life. God still used them for His glory. The same God who uses us for His glory. We come here to worship Him and thank Him for saving us, even though we messed up, we're not any good. Even though I'm a sinner, He still sent Jesus Christ to die for me. It's amazing. Sometimes we think, oh, I'm not worthy. I didn't deserve it. You know that He did anyway. The Bible is full of sinners. God still used them. He will use us. people that come and they witness to us, that believe us, it's not them. God used them to save us. And God uses other people. This morning, I was watching John MacArthur. The message really touched my heart. I used a lot of reading about Mark Driscoll, but right now I turned away from the gospel. He was born and turned away. The other one, whose name, McDonald? Yeah, James McDonald, turned away from the gospel. Bam! It changes the people. You look at many people like that. Then, at first, they're wonderful, and then they change. It's sad to see. More and more women pastors. I mean, rebellion against the Bible. That they are rebelling against the word. A strong word. Many people don't like John MacArthur, but I respect him. He's a very good pastor. He stands firm for God's word. Anyways, I'm thinking about that. The mustard seed. Smallest seed becomes a big tree. I know that death many times they feel kind of small. And they go and they live in a place where there's not a lot of deaf people, so they go to a church with an interpreter or even, you know, Bible on Zoom or whatever. The deaf have very limited resources. Hearing people have plenty of opportunity to go to church. You know, they have radio, they have, you know, they say, oh, I don't need to go to church because I listen on the radio all the time. I listen to church on the radio all the time. Everywhere I drive, I listen to it on the radio. Hearing people have lots of resources, but they don't have that same opportunity. The opportunity for them to hear the gospel is small, but we're still growing. At that time, the Roman Empire, there was a lot of cults. It was very big in the Roman Empire. They had gods that they worshipped. There were many. You know, they had a lot of orgies and gay and all of that. It was similar to our times today. The Roman Empire was the same type of way. Evil was there and it was horrendous. The Roman Empire was very evil. Now understand that evil, there's nothing new under the sun. The evil has always been. This doesn't get completely better, it goes back to bad. It gets a little better, goes back to bad. You know, today, when I was young, I used to watch kind of like evil movies or whatever, but now that I watch them, it just makes me sick. You know the movie Dirty Dancing? You know, Patrick Swayze or whatever, Dirty Dancing, made in 1950s. Talking about the 1950s. Some people say, oh, 1950s is better than now, but are you sure? No. Maybe, but behind closed doors, this side of the sun. It was rampant. We just don't want to see it. So even from Roman times to today, you know, evil has always been there. You know, maybe there's a little bit of good here in the forefront, but in behind, this is enough. You know, the evil now that was more open, more visible, Evil has always been around them. The church is small. Even like a mustard seed. But the church grows and grows and grows. So, the pagan cults of Roman times had many different gods. They had a cult of monarchs. There were other cults. It felt very small at that time compared to all the many cults that were around. But the church, one of them, like most of the group, the cults are no longer around. But the church is still strong. And since Roman times to now, the church is still strong, still spreads the gospel, even in places like China and communism. Still in places like Iran, who hate Christians, the gospel still spreads. Even in Muslim extremist countries, people make fun of Christians who don't do anything bad, but they try to respect Muslims who are extreme. Says a mustard seed is so small when planted, but when it grows, it's so big that even the birds come and nest on its branches. I love the way that Christ describes its spread. The world tries to make Christians look bad. It tries to put down Christians or what their church is doing, but still, they come and they rest in the branches of a tree of the church. Small and still growing. Made it to death. If we set up churches, we could grow too. Let me tell what Arce is about. I love the way that he heard of life is very interesting. He could have been a millionaire, he could have been very wealthy. In West Pennsylvania, he bought something in Nicole, West Pennsylvania. But I want to share that story next time. I don't want to elaborate too much on it. But anyways, he was going to church, and he had two things full time. He focused on theology teaching. OM director. Okay, so studying the Bible, and someone came to me and said, "Hey, you should pastor the church." I said, "Oh, no, I'm just so busy with these two jobs." See, and that person said, "You really should pastor." I just said, "Let me pray about it first. I mean, feel a little bit convicted about it. Should I preach? Should I teach?" Anyway, you get the other for Bible study. The Bible study group said, "Please set up a church. They not only preach, teach, that's it. Now, for other people need to do the pastoral care, okay?" I said, "Sure, okay." A really small church. But that church grew and grew and grew and grew and grew. You know, what do you even dream? The church was small. It grew 2,000 members. It wasn't fun. It's the way that God does. Smart, but it was something small. Be faithful to the word and study. Churches that would start with two or three, they would grow. And they would, once they grew, they would become churches of their own. You know that deaf need. Hearing don't need. There's many, many hearing churches. Deaf need churches. Need. was as the smallest of seeds, but had grown taller than house plants. With him getting hurt. It's interesting. The church used to take care of orphans and widows. That's their responsibility to take care of orphans and widows, take care of the poor, you know, to educate people. Today, though, there's not that much where the churches take care of orphans. And there's a few here and there. You know, churches don't take care of the widows. They don't take care of the poor. And governments stole those responsibilities. Okay, they take those responsibilities away from the church. The government said that they are God. They're going to take care of the Democrats. Awful when they try to push a church out. The church needs to take care of its people. It can, but the government took over that responsibility. It's a thing that has happened. It stole the church's responsibility. It won't last long. Eventually it will fall. Too much responsibility for the government to do. God, though, God can do what the government can't. When the government sees all the people that need help, the government can't do it all, but God can. And uses his people to help. The government has stolen that responsibility, right? But God is still growing the church. The government rises and falls all the time, but the church remains. Church is still steadfast. Even though governments come about, rise and fall, that's the way it is, because they're trying to be equal with God, but they can't. They fall. The church remains, because we depend on God. We know who God is, that he provides. And right here, in local, at 18. Remote members, we have 18. Live people that watch our videos. I think 200, 500 some days. 1,000, I mean, we don't know. We put 100, you know, the people that who tell me they watch our service. I'd say roughly 100, but there's more. It's still growing. It's still growing. We're still spreading the gospel. I hope that 18, we can, you know, 6 maybe set up their own churches. We need to pray for them. You know, but on Zoom, I hope that we'll be able to fellowship with our brothers and sisters on Zoom. That they set up their own churches where they live. Maybe someday you guys will become pastors and go and preach. Who knows? Hidden. It's still spreading. You know, like Iran, other places like that. They're in churches all over the world. And the Bible attests to that. The Romans, they persecuted Christ fiercely. You know, even underground Christians were able to spread the word of God. It says the kingdom of heaven is like leaven. Okay, you can't see leaven. It's hidden. It's small. But it makes bread big, right? Without leaven, bread is flat. And add leaven, it makes it boom. It's invisible, but it's still working. To rise things up. That's amazing the way that yeast works to build bread. It's delicious, right? Jesus told the crowds of these parables, things that will happen. Okay? they would be fulfilled. The Jews, all the way up until that time, when Jesus was alive, Jesus was telling them, be prepared, be ready, because the gospel is going into the Gentiles, not just the Jews. Jesus told them in his words, I think, in Ephesians 4:3 or somewhere in there, it talks about Jesus comes because he has another fold of sheep. So who's that other fold of sheep that he's talking about? Who's he bringing up? That's the Gentiles. Some Mormons say they're the other fold, but that's made up. It's crazy. Really, that is the Gentiles. The Gentiles are the ones that Jesus was talking about, you and me. And they do. And then we were able to be saved. Now maybe you were thinking, and you get discouraged because of the way society is around you, the way the government is taking control. Wish we could, you know, remove the government from all the control over the churches. As this DM, we know that the government is taking control of what the church should be doing. Maybe death can be independent. It'd be nice for the church to have support. I mean, here in churches have doctors, they have business people, they have lawyers. That people do not typically have lots of money. So the support is a lot less within the deaf church. It's very hard for deaf people often to get jobs. And the deaf are often rejected from employment because of employers. So that's why a lot of them have SSI, because it's very hard to find jobs. Many of you today here are more qualified than other people, but they hearing people are able to get jobs easier, even though they're less qualified. I said 80% of you are better than some of those hearing people that got a job over you, simply because they can speak and communicate. Deaf people, it's harder to communicate because they have to have interpreters or whatever. That's the way that it is today. The government has ruined it. And you blame the government. You know, minimum wage set today has ruined us. Before there was no minimum wage, then the city was decided on their own. A long time ago, they hired a deaf person. They realized they were wonderful workers and they would raise so they would have enough money because they were really great workers. But minimum wage. They hire people who are not like good workers. And now that we want to raise minimum wage to $15, they're just like, that's dumb. And then more and more deaf people will be unemployed because they have to compete with other hearing people. It doesn't matter if you're a really great worker, it's even harder for us to get jobs. There is no minimum wage, it should be easier for us to get a job. Hearing people like to hire cheap, so they would hire a deaf person because they're cheap, but realize that they're such great workers, then they would increase their wage and it was easier for them to get a job. The government is dumb. Okay, they don't know how to run things. Church knows. We can see a clear picture of what Christ has done for us. It makes me sad. Sometimes you feel as if you're out of step because you're in church on Sunday mornings while your friends and neighbors are on the golf course or at the beach or sleeping in. Some of you get tired from work. You know, you had a bad week, whatever it is, but your heart's on fire and you want to come. Maybe you look at others, you get to sleep in, and you get to come to church. You know, see people out in the golf course or whatever, and wonder if they're saved. Did they know Jesus? You know, my heart aches for those people. Those who are out on the beach this morning. Oh, my favorite place to be. It's Sunday, go worship. Those people out there, they're missing something amazing. You are in the midst of the kingdom of heaven. Every time believers gather together in the name of Christ for the purpose of public worship, we experience music, prayers, the preaching, the feeding of our souls. The tiny mustard seed grows into a huge tree in our hearts. They are missing the taste of the kingdom of Christ. It's here, right now, right here in our church. Okay, in the room, you're surrounded by the room. But when you're here, you're surrounded by believers. Encourage. You know, if you're out on your own, set up a church. Because our church is the kingdom of God. Those people in the world, they're missing out. One day, we're into heaven with Christ for eternity. We will feel the full power of His presence. All pain and, gather together, worship Jesus. Eat together, fellowship together. We don't know what it really looked like. This is imagination, but now with the bridegroom, a place that is filled, completely satisfied. Here, we just get a piece of what heaven looks like when we come together, when we die, and we're in His presence. We're with Him, full embodiment for the Lord. Elders or whatever. The picture is not exact, okay? I don't want to try to misinterpret. This is not an exact picture. The idea that was us worshiping. Revelation 22 says it will be a crystal lake. The sun will go and we'll be there together. Music. There'll be no illness, no grieving, no heartache, sorrow. No pain. Maybe you guys said that pain. I woke up, I'll get ready, and I had like a stretch thing from my leg. Oh, that pain. And in heaven, I'll be able to move and spin it all the way around. There'll be no pain at all. In heaven, I'll be able to spin my leg all the way around. Now I can hardly lift it up without pain. Because here on earth, we're in pain. But heaven won't be like that. We will look forward to someday. Some people say, I can't wait to be in heaven. So, like, some people say, oh, I can't wait to see my mom. I can't wait to see my dad. Do you know your mom will actually be in heaven? Do you know your dad will actually be in heaven? Oh, but they were Christians. We don't know. Nobody knows. You know, many people inside, they truly don't love Christ. Many people can play the part. The Bible says, there are those who go before Christ. Maybe those who we thought were strong Christians will actually go to hell. We don't know. We don't know the truth. Because people say when somebody dies, are they going to heaven or an angel in heaven? But you don't know. We can't determine. We can't say all people are going to heaven. There's many people that go to heaven. Most people are going to hell. When we say that, because it makes us feel better, it makes us feel good. But it's not the truth, you know? But be very careful and say, I would rather keep the truth than add it alone. I never say, I can't, I'm not God, I'm a man, I'm a sinner, just like you. You can't say if they went to heaven or hell, you know? Dan never opens up and says, hey, that person went to heaven. He's going to never tell me that. I don't have access to that. Only God has access to that information. So we need to be very careful and just trust that Jesus, with all our hearts, you know, that he did all the work for you on the cross. He died. He rose again. And praise him for that. And we should look forward to heaven with Jesus, not with your mom or your dad or your wife or your husband or your brother or your sister or whoever. Look forward to heaven with Jesus. If someone who says, I can't wait to go to heaven so I can be with my mom or my dad, obviously they don't understand the truth. We need to look for heaven to be with Christ. If my wife died, I can't look forward to going to heaven to see my wife. Because she's not Jesus. I'm going to look forward to Jesus. Remember, when you're in heaven, your mother or your father or your wife or husband, they're not your dad. We need to look forward to being with God. Another part, R.C. Sproul, one professor, I think I've said that before, he said, you get to heaven where no tears, no sickness, no grief, no pain. My mother wasn't a believer about it. She went to hell. It makes me sad. You don't get it. When you die, your body is different. Your thinking is different. Your mind is different. You're happy. New body. And worship before the Lord. And with Christ. R.C. Sproul was like, that's impossible. And his teacher said it's true. You know that those who are against Christ are wicked. Even your closest family member, if they were against Christ, are wicked. Okay, you won't be sad or crying for them because they're in hell. You'll be so happy to be in heaven with Christ. Our minds are very limited. That's true. You don't understand how it works. Someday we will understand the mystery of holiness. There's no pollution before it. In prison. It's important that we love God first. Love our neighbors, yes. Okay. Let's pray. Father in heaven. We're small, but we grow and we praise you, even if we're underground and people don't see it. Instead, spread the word, the gospel, reaching out to those. For the leaven that rises the bread. And we need to the praise and the truth of the heaven and the earth. And the Father, and the Son, and the Father. Mm-hmm. died. 3 days later, he rose again. Maybe there is. And then he ascended into heaven.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe there's some praise. Jesus is. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. Our eyes look to him. We pray. Psalm 66, verse 20. God bless you and happy resurrection. Every day. That's a prayer. Thank him for this offering. I pray for every day, Lord. I give him money for you so we can help others. This man, because Jesus is our life. He gave his life for his death. In his name, we pray. Amen.